Hey, brothers and sisters, this is your favorite brother, hallelujah, from another mother. Hope you guys are all doing all right tonight. Praise the living God, brothers and sisters. I got about four or five different, rabbit trails or things that the Lord is trying to show me that I'm trying to follow, I'm trying to work on. It seems like, I had audio trouble on the video that I did before it was live, and I don't know if it was, that's when I discussed this stuff up. One of these things I want to talk about tonight, I'd mentioned, I was watching some videos of tours of the Holy Land, and because the Lord was leading me to particular topics I was following of historical, archaeological sites there. Because I've studied all these things, but I've never seen pictures of lots of these places, so I was watching the videos to look at it, and I heard something new I'd never heard before. Well, it was like this. Okay, first, I was looking, the Lord had me watching these videos about stuff I'd seen some before about the tabernacle in the wilderness. And on the showbread that they had 12 loaves of showbread, like for the 12 tribes of Israel in the holy place. But they're in two stacks of six. And I mean, they said that, that's what it says in the Bible, to have, these two stacks of six bread. And then all of a sudden, it's like the Lord just, struck me with a bolt of lightning and said, it's like the 666. That's the first two sixes, Of course, the number of man is six. And never crossed my mind or would never even think of that. And I was like, okay, all right. And then I was like, well, I don't know what the third six could be. And I was, I was messaging with Brother Gary about that. And Brother Gary Bear, 049 channel, Bear 049, Gary Bear's channel. And I think we were texting something about it, and I emailed him, and I was saying, this is what something the Lord has shown me, but I don't know what the third six is. Of course, man is, it's like saying that the Antichrist is from Israel, or like the 12 tribes, and of course, the number of man is six, so maybe that's the third six is, of course, he's a man or whatever. I don't know. But anyhow, so a few days later, I was watching these archaeological videos, and wherever the Israelites stopped and they set up a camp under Joshua after they crossed into the Holy Land, they camped into the giant shape of a foot, the right foot. Like, I never heard that before, but I mean, it's there. It's archaeological evidence is there. And what it is, of course, and I thought about it before, I mean, God had told Abraham, wherever your foot treads, you have authority in that place. When God told Abraham when he was going to the Holy Land, when God said, leave the land of your fathers and go to a land I will show you, and I'll make you a great and mighty nation. And so, and he said, God promised Abraham, wherever your foot treads, you have authority in that place. You're taking over. It's yours when you step there, everywhere you step. And so that's what it was basically like under Joshua. The symbol of the nation of Israel was the right footprint, meaning like the right foot of Abraham. These are the children of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob. So, and it makes total sense to me. And I'd even thought about it years ago, one symbol of Israel would be a footprint. Years ago I thought about that. But I never knew that they had thought about it before I was ever on this world. Before any of us were ever in the world, 1,500 years before Christ, 1,400 years here, they were doing it. I never heard that before. Never heard a word about this. And so I was watching, they were showing it, and I was like, well, that's pretty cool. And then the guy who's an archaeologist was saying, well, there's six of these footprints throughout where they camped when they were taking the Holy Land under Joshua. And I was like, then all of a sudden the Lord hit me again and said, well, there's another six related to what I'm trying to show you. I was like, whoa, wait a minute. It's like, well, I don't know. It's just there. It's like the Lord had shown me the other thing about the bread. And I was like, well, it's just there. It's a hanging chad. It's just like, I don't know exactly what all it means, unless the Lord shows me. And so again, tonight, check it out. Joshua is the sixth book in the Bible. Joshua is the sixth book in the Bible. So now, we talk about the 666. I've never been into looking at the 666 except when the Lord was showing me. A lot of people, it's like their whole thing, right? But the Bible does tell us, who has wisdom, let him count the number of the beast, for it's the number of a man, 666. So the Bible tells us to calculate it. So it's not, you know, so it's something that we can do. And I hear people say, oh, you shouldn't try to figure it out. Well, it says to do it. But I mean, for me personally, I'm like, well, you know, I'm following Jesus and I'm into Jesus, but the Lord obviously wants this out to his church. So that's what I'm working on. So anyway, so it's the sixth book of the Old Testament, the whole Bible is Joshua. And, you know, there's other things I looked at in the past. I just want to say there's lots of stuff in Solomon about 666. Of course, Solomon, you know, fell away and in the end, he married all these foreign women and built temples to them. And in the end, God split the kingdom because of the sin of King Solomon. And he did not punish Solomon in his lifetime because of promises he had made to King David. And that's, you know, what he said to Solomon. When Solomon heard it, he said, okay, great, it won't happen in my lifetime. That showed you a lot about his attitude right there. But every year for his birthday, he received 666 talents of gold for his birthday. And then it's like I haven't looked at the Solomon one in a long time because the Lord had, you know, had me looking at it. I made a video about a year or two ago. And again, it was a hanging chad. I didn't know what all the Lord was trying to tell me, but, you know, it's like the dimensions of his throne or something is another 666 or several more 666s involved. I think it's six steps or whatever to his throne and whatever. There's lots of 666s in there, with King Solomon. Now, of course, another thing too, the modern day Israeli flag, that star on there is, it says in the book of Acts, you worship the star of Raphim, as Stephen is talking about in Acts chapter 7 and 8. A lot of people believe, of course, that star that people call the Star of David is actually the Star of Solomon, which is some of this Kabbalism kind of a thing, a Kabbalah kind of a deal. And there's these stories, and who knows how much of it's true, that Solomon had this ring that he thought he could use to control demons. Now, I don't know how much of that was, you know. And then Freemasonry is, their base or their foundation is supposed to really come from the building of King Solomon's temple. And so it's just like America. Think about this. You know, you got the double pattern, you know, so you got to think about it in this way, you know, and you got to, you know, stop thinking two-dimensional, three-dimensional, and think four, five, six-dimensional. America, number one producer of pornography, you know, and all kinds of bad stuff, whatever. But yet, the number one producer of Bibles, producer of preachers, you know, all the great preachers of the last 150 years, Billy Graham or whatever people talk about, almost all, not all, but from the United States. And so, the theological seminaries and all that that's led the way in eschatology and all this, end times, Christianity and all that's been from America. So that's a two-edged sword. And so the same thing you're seeing with King Solomon and all that. It's a two-edged sword with him particularly. And so, but let me get back to Joshua. So another thing here that's connected to this, there are 66 books in the canon of scripture. And of course, and I've looked at this years ago when I was going to school, Isaiah, of course, is 66 books. Some of you may have heard this, but I'm talking about it in connection with the Antichrist. And I'm not exactly sure how, but yet I'm still working on it, but I want to put it out here because it's exciting. The Lord's got me looking at four or five different paths that are very exciting. And I usually don't share it, you know, I just forget to share it. But anyway, so in the pattern of Isaiah, many of you probably might know this, but in the first 39 books of Isaiah, it's like the judgment of God. The first 39 books of the Bible is the Old Testament. And then starting in book 40, which would be equivalent to Matthew in the 40th book of the Bible, it starts talking exhortation and good stuff and about the kingdom and all that. So even Isaiah chapter 1 talks about the creation, and Isaiah 66, the last book, talks about the new kingdom, the new heaven and the new earth, just as the Bible in Revelation and Genesis. So there's all these patterns. But there's still, I'm looking at a whole different angle. I'm looking at this pattern of the 6-6. You got the 6, the showbread. You got 6 and 6. 6-6 showbread, 6 of each, equaling the 12 tribes. Then you've got 66 books. Well, of course, you've got the 12 tribes, and then you got the 12 apostles. You know, the 6-6 thing doubled again. And so, I mean, there's the pattern of the kingdom of God side and then the kingdom of the Antichrist side. So I'm kind of looking at it from both ways. And so in the 6th chapter of Joshua, which I'm just looking at this, I got to get into it. But in the 6th chapter of Joshua, in the 6th verse, Joshua commands them, you know, you're going to march around this Jericho you know, one day, every day for 6 days, like the 6,000 years of history. And then the seventh day they blow, you know, you'll blow the trumpets once or whatever. Then at the end of the seventh time, you have seven trumpet blowers, all those times blowing the trumpet seven times or whatever. I haven't even looked at the text since since the Lord was, you know, I was getting on this tonight. Then they shout and it falls down. You know, you can go read it yourself. So I'm not exactly sure if I'm saying exactly how it goes, but I mean, I'm just touching on it because it's been years since I've sat there and just studied it. But it's, again, it's like the seven trumpets of Revelation. So it's all tied into the Antichrist. And of course, the return of the Lord's got both things going on. So in the book of Revelation, there's seven trumpets, you know, seven seals, seven churches, seven bowls, seven trumpets. Seven, everything is seven, the completion of God. Six is man. Seven is the completion of God. We've got 6 days. Seventh day is the Sabbath. Rest, in the creation. Then you have the, 7 years. It's a sabbatical year. It's the seventh year. Then seven sevens, 49 years. Then the 50th year is the year of Jubilee. Then they've got the Feast of Weeks, which you have, the seven sevens again with 49, ends up with the same thing with 50, being the Jubilee again. And so it's the whole, with the Pentecost and all that. So it's over and over again, these patterns that God uses. So seven is the completion of God, a completion of the work of God and the rest in Christ and in God. And then the six is is a man. So the work of man, it can be positive too. Of course, it's like, Jesus was the Son of Man. So you've got man. But then the Antichrist is also, as it says, his number is the same as a man, equal to a man, 666. So there's so many things here that I'm just touching on the surface of, and I got to get down into it. But it says in the book of Revelation, chapter 10, when the angel, there's a giant angel with a rainbow around his head, and a lot of people believe that's, Jesus Christ, because he has a rainbow around his head and the things that he does, one foot on the land, one foot on the sea. So that's one foot in Israel, one foot in the Gentile nations, in that symbolic what the Bible says. And he says that when the seventh trumpet begins to sound, it'll be the end of all things. I mean, all the mystery of God will be revealed. It'll be the end. And so you see this seventh trumpet. So again, here in Joshua, this, the seven trumpets, and then they shout, and then the walls fall down. So it's like Jericho is like a type of the kingdom of Antichrist. The king of Jericho is like the type of the Antichrist. So there's a whole lot of things I got to dig into to get into it, but I wanted to share it with you because it's very interesting, very exciting. And then I heard a theory from a Bible teacher that I've never heard before that I thought was pretty cool about who are the 144,000 witnesses. I give him credit. His name's Brother Doug Stauffer or something like that. But it's when you read in Matthew chapter 2, because it says 144,000 witnesses are virgin Israeli males. And so people say, well, how could that be? Maybe it means spiritual virgins, or they repented or whatever. What does that mean? Are they literal virgins? So how would you have 144,000, men that are virgins? Well, in the text, Matthew chapter 2, when all the male babies were murdered in the time of King Moses. Check this out. They killed all the baby boys when it was time for Moses to be born. And then they killed all the baby boys when it was, when King Herod had them killed there in Ramah, in Bethlehem, when he thought that Jesus, the Messiah was going to be born. Matthew chapter 2. So, and it quotes there about Rachel, crying and all that. In Matthew chapter 2, and it's a quote from Jeremiah. Well, when you go back and look at Jeremiah chapter 31, start at 15, 16, and 17, it talks about, about the, Rachel mourning for her children who died. But then it says, but your children will come back. Your children will come back. So you go back and read that Jeremiah 31, 15 through 17. You see that it's almost a prophecy that these children would be resurrected. They would come back. And so what this brother was saying, this Bible teacher, he's a very good Bible teacher. And he looks at all these things, he's outside the box. The two witnesses are, coming back. And of course, I believe, as I've said in videos many times in the past, Moses and Elijah, those are the two that appeared to Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration, Moses and Elijah. And so Moses and Elijah is coming back. And then why not all those children, those male children that were killed in Bethlehem, the male children that were killed when Moses was about to be born? And how about, he even suggests during the Holocaust, there were thousands and thousands of, young men who would be virgins, that were killed as male children, let's say up through whatever it is, 16 or whatever, who could be these witnesses. So that's a great theory. I never thought about that because the two witnesses come back. Why not this? And he bases it off that prophecy of Jeremiah that's quoted in Matthew 2, Jeremiah 31:15-17. That's pretty cool. I never heard that before. And it makes sense. It's a great theory. I never even heard anything like it, but sounds like something God would do. I thought was cool. And I've got several other tracks of study that the Lord's got me doing on other totally different topics about the rapture, Daniel chapter 9, and the rapture, which I'll get into another time. So I wanted to share those two with you and just ask you guys to pray. The Lord will continue to give me wisdom about following this 666 thing, because he's just dropping it on me, bits and bits and pieces here. And, you know, I don't know until he tells me what all is going with. I mean, it's just like, okay, the Antichrist is Jewish. Well, you know, when I read the book of Revelation, it says that the first beast, who's the Antichrist, Revelation chapter 13, says he comes out of the sea. Revelation 13 started verse 1. And so in biblical prophecy, the sea means the Gentile nations. The goyim is the, you know, Hebrew word. Goyim is plural for, you know, outlanders, you know, foreigners. And then the second beast, who is the false prophet, the Bible says comes out of the beautiful land. So that represents Israel. And so now this is, you know, standard interpretation through the Bible, but, you know, that doesn't mean it could be something different, because, I mean, we only know what we know, and it's not till the Lord reveals it to us and explains it to us that we understand things. Just like what I said about the 144,000 witnesses. I mean, that could turn out to be true, and it's so far outside the paradigm of the way people think, but it sounds like something that's highly possible, because that's the way God operates. But anyway, the brother said this too. You know, we talk about the two witnesses being Moses and Elijah, and people say, well, you know, it's appointed unto man once to die, and then the judgment, and that's the argument why people say it's Enoch. Well, I want to say this about that. Well, of course, Lazarus died, and he was raised again. Elijah raised one child from the dead. Elisha raised a child from the dead, and another man was raised to the dead when his body hit the bones of Elisha. And so in the Bible, and then Jesus raised another young man from the dead, and he raised a little girl from the dead. And I'm sure they all died later on, so they died twice. So I would say that it's appointed unto man once to die, and then the judgment. I think that's telling us, A, there's no reincarnation, and it's just, you know, the standard rule. But I mean, not everybody dies. As we know, Enoch and Elijah went up into the air that we know about. Maybe other people got individually raptured that we don't know about, brothers and sisters, throughout history. It's true in the Bible. And it's also true to be said that Enoch was raptured before the flood. See, because Enoch's daddy was Methuselah. And Methuselah died. In the year Methuselah died, the flood came. And his name means, you know, at his death, the judgment comes or destruction comes. So Methuselah, the man who lived to be the oldest man in the world, 969 years, that's the father of Enoch. So based on the pattern of all their living, Methuselah died the year the flood came. So Enoch, if he was following the pattern of all of his forefathers, he would have been alive there in the flood. You know, but God took him. He left in 360 years, long before anybody else died in their, you know, of age. And so Enoch really is a type of the church, the rapture, because he preached, as it says in the New Testament, he's a preacher of righteousness. So he was calling in the course of there's apocryphal books that tell about his ministry and what all he said and what all he did, like the book of Enoch. And then there's the book of Jubilees, which is known as the little Genesis. And I know how much of that stuff is true or not. The Bible refers to the book of Jubilees, but that doesn't mean the one we have is the book of Jubilees. You know, that's not in the canon. So we don't know. Parts of it may be real and parts of it are not. I don't know. I mean, I read it. And in there, it's all about, you know, a big part of that is about Elijah and how he would preach and, you know, how he was taken up. And it was the first time it ever snowed. And there was a snowstorm that God sent to black people from following him, because all the young men who were his disciples wanted to follow him into heaven, and God blocked them. But who knows if that's true or not. But the thing about it is Enoch walked with God, and he was no more because God took him. And so I made a video years ago saying, you want to be raptured? You got to walk with God. So God will take you like he did Enoch. And so Enoch is a type of the rapture. Methuselah is the type of the dead in Christ. Noah is a type of a tribulation saint. You know, really, he made it through. Lot is a type, which I made a video years ago, the most viewed video I ever made. was called The Lord Showed Me Who Would Be Raptured and Who Would Not. It's only a 10-minute video. That's probably why it's seen so much. Most of my videos are way long. That's why I don't get all the views. This video was 10 minutes long, and it's had like 350,000 views. And it's the thing that the Lord showed me that time about the five wise virgins are those who will be raptured and the five foolish virgins. I never had thought about it before, you know, too much about that. I mean, if people are supposed to be born again, they'll be raptured. But no, the Lord was showing me it's like Revelation 3:10. Those who have patiently kept his word, as Jesus said, they would be kept out of the tribulation. In Luke 21:36, when the Lord said, watch and pray, therefore, always that you be kind of worthy to escape these things and stand before the Son of Man. So how could you be worthy? By patiently keeping his word, Revelation 3:10. And so you've got Lot is a type of a tribulation saint. Abraham is a type of the rapture, which I talked about in that video, my first video on the topic. Where I got into this, you know, the revelation, you know, understanding, it's really illumination. Revelation is like a new Bible verse. No, I got an illumination from the word, from the Lord of this meaning. And so Abraham is a type of the church because Abraham, he saw the destruction from a distance. Abraham was on top of the mountain looking down. So, I mean, I guess he could also be like the type of the dead in Christ. I mean, he was not near the place. And God told him in advance, this is what I'm going to do. And Abraham interceded. That God would not do it if he, you know, found at least 10 righteous people, but he didn't find 10 righteous people. So Lot's wife is a type of a person who loved the world so much. For Lot's wife loved the world so much that she gave up her only husband and her only God and turned to a pillar of salt. That's kind of the anti-John 3:16. And so Lot's wife, she's a type of a person who's supposed to be a Christian, but it's a backslider, get left behind, but yet then she took the mark. And Lot is a type who was a backslider, a lukewarm, living in the world, in love with the world, loved up with the world. But because he was, you know, a Laodicean Christian, I mean, the Lord warned him and through angels, and he was able to escape. But he lost everything. It's a type of tribulation saint. And he barely got out, you know, by the skin of his teeth. And his wife made the wrong decision. His son-in-laws made the wrong decision. So only two of his daughters, you know, if you read the King James, you'll see that, you know, in these other translations, these modern translations, which are based off of forged text, apocryphal origin text, I'll put it that way, they, you know, make it look like Lot didn't have any other children. But when you read the King James from the Masoretic text, which is goes all the way back, we have copies from the Dead Sea scrolls that is, you know, that they've been discovered since 1948. King James uses the original correct Hebrew text. Goes all the way back, that we have copies all the way back now, since 1948, to the Dead Sea Scrolls. And in there, you read the text, you'll see that Lot had, obviously had sons-in-laws. And so his daughters, who were married to these son-in-laws, they were under the control of their husband, like it was all the way up to the last, since, you know, the 1960s. The husband was the leader of his house, and still supposed to be in the ordinances of God. But so Lot went there and tried to talk to his son-in-laws. And say, hey, you guys, we need to get out of here. But they laughed him to scorn and mocked him. So Lot was so lukewarm and so loved up with Sodom that his son-in-laws didn't respect him or take him seriously. So he only escaped with his two virgin daughters, unmarried maidens who were still living at home, went with him. But his wife turned back. She's like a type of someone that took the mark. And so let's see. I think I've covered most of that. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I just was on a roll there to just talk about these things as the things that's in my mind and in my heart from the Lord. I've got these whole other topics that I don't want to start on because I'll never get done like I normally do. And like I said, if I made those 10-minute videos like I did that had 350,000 views, I probably would because, you know, it's nice that more people would see it because who knows how many people repented from seeing that video. I don't have no idea. Or, you know, got saved or repented. I couldn't tell you. So when I do the longer videos, it's more for discipleship of those who are already serious in Christ and who know, you know, how I am and, you know, my long videos and all that. But, you know, so that's, you know, it's two different things that are both great. Anyway, brothers and sisters, love you all. I want to do some praise and worship. I'll do a praise and worship later. Come back. And by the grace of God, I'll be doing live videos again whenever the Lord leads me. Because, you know, I've been having those audio issues with YouTube. So we'll see how that all works out, brothers and sisters. But it's all in the hands of our Lord. I love you all, brothers and sisters. I want you guys to know that. I want you to know the Bible, no matter, you know, history of different teachings, even though, as I just want to say this quickly, it goes back, Irenaeus, book 4, Against Heresies, Irenaeus was a disciple of a man named Polycarp. Polycarp was the disciple of John, who wrote the book of Revelation and the Gospel of John and all that. And Irenaeus was the first one to write that there would be a catching away, that the text says what it means, what it says. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16, 17, and 18. There'll be a catching away, a pre-wrath, a pre-tribulation catching away of the bride of Christ, the true Christians, the five wise virgins. And there, if you do a simple Google search, you will see that people were teaching that. Church fathers were teaching that all the way back to the second century. Irenaeus is the first one that I know of who wrote about it. There's probably some before him, but we might not have a copy of what they wrote. So it was a teaching since the second century. Now, in the 1800s or seven, I take that back, as Dr. Jack Van Impe had done a study on it, maybe the 16th or 17th century, people started using this theological term, the rapture, to describe this catching away. So the word rapture comes from the Latin word for catching away, to be caught up by force, is where we get the word rapture. The Latin is rapiro, whatever it is. It doesn't matter. The word rapture is a theological term, just like theology is a theological word. Bible, you know, it's like this. Language is some way that we communicate to each other. So if I say to you, many of you, when watching the news, you know what is habeas corpus, okay? I have the body. You know, everyone knows a little bit. They'll know what ex parte is. In a FISA warrant, the prosecutor from the DOJ talks to the judges of the FISA court ex parte, meaning apart from, away from the defendant, the other party. So when a lawyer talks to a judge without the defense, you know, the other side there, the prosecutor or the defendant's lawyer, it's called ex parte communication, which is supposed to be illegal. But so when I say ex parte, it's not a, who cares that it's a, you know, 2,000-year-old Latin expression? Who cares the origin and the meaning of each word? What matters is in modern legalese, the term ex parte means a specific thing. It doesn't matter anything about the spelling or how or whatever. It's a term that's used in legal circles to describe a type of thing. So in theology, like the word theology, the word Bible is a standard accepted word for the book, the 66 books of the canon of Scripture. But the word Bible is not in the Bible. The word Bible comes from Syria or whatever it is, ancient Syria, the Assyrians or whatever, Philistines or something. I learned that in school, and you know why? It went right down the toilet. You know why? Because it doesn't matter. When you say Bible, language, as I said, is a means of communication between two people. So when I say Bible, you know what I mean. So it doesn't matter the origin of the word Bible because it's the term we use. So when you use the term rapture, it doesn't matter who coined the term, how old is the term. It's an accepted term to describe a doctrine, which is the pre-tribulation catching away of the bride of Christ. And that's what it means. And so all the noise about when they started using that term, it doesn't matter. It was a term that was coined that we all know because there's got to be a term for stuff. You know, there's a term for, you know, the way that the process in America, we have a process where the states elect the president. It's called the Electoral College. So the term used to describe it is, hey, there's the Electoral College. We know what that means. If you should know what it means, unless maybe you're a millennial, you might not know what it means because the school system has failed. But, you know, first versus direct popular vote, we have electoral college to make it fair to all the states. So it's a term, an expression that we use, and everybody knows what it means. But beyond that, it doesn't matter, you know, about the term. But we all get an understanding of what it means by saying that without having to go through all that. Well, you know, each state has the electors, and then, you know, and so each state has a certain number of electoral, you know, electorates to the Electoral College. And you don't have to describe it when I say, oh, you know, President Trump won the Electoral College, you know, more than 270 delegates you have to win to be the president. So Trump won, you know, 306, whatever it is. I don't have to go to the details describing it because you know what I'm talking about. So the rapture is the same thing. When we say the rapture, anyone that it's an accepted term that we all agree to, you know, whether people like the term or not, it was invented and it became what it is. It is what it is. That's the term they use. And so one of the biggest things you hear from people, well, the word rapture is not in the Bible. Well, the word Bible is not in the Bible. That's not an argument. That's not an argument. It's a descriptive word to describe a doctrine. So those things don't mean anything. The Bible teaches clearly, and that's not what this video is about. I've got hundreds of videos about it. People, welcome to go watch it. People can believe in the rapture or not. It's nothing to do with salvation, because we don't earn our salvation by suffering during the tribulation. Because if that was the case, you had to suffer in the tribulation to make it to heaven. The people that live for the last 2,000 years would be out of luck, because anybody that died before the tribulation started, well, they wouldn't get an opportunity to suffer in the tribulation to earn their salvation. And so the true gospel is we are saved by grace through faith, not of our own, but a gift of God, not by works, lest any man should boast. You know, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. So anybody that says you earn your righteousness by going in the tribulation, now that is a different gospel. And Paul said anyone that gives a different gospel than that, this is the same book. We're talking about the same book, Galatians. In the book of Galatians, Paul said that, you know, anybody gives you a different gospel, let them be anathema, let them be accursed, than the gospel that we gave you already, which is what I just said. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. By grace are you saved through faith, not of your own, but a gift of God, not by works, lest any man should boast. So, and then it says we're saved unto do good works. So after we say we do good works, that's a different, totally different thing. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you all. I don't want to get into all this theology. I dislike discussing theology. It's because it's always man's way of thinking. You know, it's you have to put it in. Like when Paul writes, he says, well, you know, I have to write to you like children, and, you know, I have to give you milk, and I have to, you know, break it down and talk to you as a man so that people can understand it, you know. And but for me, it's all about Jesus Christ and him crucified. And that's what it's about. It's about seeking and saving the lost, and people need to be born again. This has nothing to do with end times or no end times. How people divide the end times. The gospel is, you know, that Jesus died on the cross in our place and rose again on the third day. And whosoever believeth in him would not perish but have everlasting life. That we would call upon him, we would repent of our sins, ask the Lord to be our Lord and Savior, and follow him. And then, of course, the part of the end times that is in the gospel, it says the Lord's returning to judge the quick and the dead. That's the living and the dead. And so when he comes back to earth, he will divide those goats and sheep who are on the earth. Hallelujah. But those of us who are in heaven, the dead in Christ, and then those who got raptured, we'll be at the marriage supper of the Lamb. We'll have our crowns, as you see, as I mentioned before. Before the seals, the Lord starts opening up the seals, you got the kings and priests before his throne. They already got their crowns on, because they've already been to the judgment seat of Christ, which is after the rapture. The church is already finished. It'll be there before the throne of God. We return with him, as Jude says. The Lord returns to 10,000 of his saints to rule and reign with him on earth for 1,000 years. Praise God, brothers and sisters. God bless you all. God bless you all, brothers and sisters, tonight.